part of the government. We're still talking about this document, advertising public sector services, and we think that no program. And then, number four, this is participation within the selected areas. We have different kinds of services that will be digitized, like working warfare, health and care, police and justice, tax, civil lines, and municipality services. So, on work and welfare, we have the agency now, to develop procedures and systems for interacting with citizens. And the objective is to provide services to the individuals on a 24/7 basis. So if we have in times, we can do our banking services 24/7, we should also be able to interact with the services in the same way. In health and care, there's a lot of things that are taking place. There's an initiative to create electronic prescriptions, and also to automate the extension cards so that they can be used at the hospitals, and also to provide information portals like HealthyMobile.net, and allow for electronic patient records that can be part of the national registry and be used between health providers and within a regulation. We need a regulation system that allows this to happen. And then smart buildings, being able to maybe have buildings that monitor patients or be able to turn on lights and turn off lights, but just to heat them automatically and be able to provide that much energy support and so forth. These things that can be automated into buildings. One example would be for elderly healthcare care. You might have buildings that identify when certain patients have dementia, they wander off. They were in the building as they collect the building. And then the use of health and place of work to mental health for might be between health providers and that's what between different health providers. And it says here that the intention of hosting maybe that amount by the self-service solutions for making appointments with primary citizens to do immune prescriptions and so forth. On the issue of taxes, most people pay their taxes electronically today, meaning they just, in Norway, most people say simply just sending an approval of the tax forms prepared for you. And if there's any additional information, you have to be provided and provide the information. And this can all be done online. And most people take that option and they're even submitting their tax returns by the mobile phone. It depends, of course, on the level of your complexity of your tax form. And then, this is one of the first services to become digitized. And we accessed this through this scott.com.no, and we saw that on the mobile.no that to the London screen. And again, using the VID to access that. And then municipalities, they might be trying to serve the public sector better. And so they gave a couple of good examples, like some municipalities will report when there's faults in street lights, or when you have to move cars because of cleaning of the roads and so forth. So different types of communication with the public from the municipality. And then the positive encounter with the public service. It says that the contact about those images to be fast, understandable, and carried out in the second amendment. And this is how documents are to be made available, and how the kind of language that's used within the documents should be understandable and made clear. And so this should be provide good information about procedures and how to communicate. And then the use of social media in the public sector. This should encourage further participation by the citizens. This is the state regulatory. This has to do with many different groups and many times sometimes complicated messages. Social media may be used to reach new targeted audiences. So one example might be how the health stations communicate with the parents that can visit the health station with their children. They might send SMS messages, for example, and maybe create a Facebook website so that they can parents can actually talk to each other. As the state regulatory evaluates the quality of the public website. The district works to improve on the quality of municipality and state websites, and they have an assessment program for that. And that the public sector is to use plain and understandable language for that. Many people consider forms very difficult to read, and by the end of 2015, business expenses are to be reduced by 10 billion, and it will require close to collaboration from the public sector and the business industry. But public sector is to use plain and understandable language. And then the data that more than all know, this is work on operations. Associated services, making information available to the public database, access to databases. Better execution and use of resources within the public sector. This has to do with government procurement processes and how the government invoices and uses electronic invoicing to purchase supplies. The government should integrate digitization inside the procurement processes. So it talks about the digital exchange of documents between agencies, that the government intends for digital to be the default, and that this will save resources and manual work in the work processes, like avoid scanning, avoid postage of documents, and all of these steps in the procurement process can be cut out. Electronic invoicing at suppliers. The state receives 4.5 million invoices from suppliers each year, and many of these are submitted by paper, but as of July 2012, the state requires invoicing. Electronic invoicing for all new contracts entered into with suppliers. So the transition is already taking place from traditional invoicing to electronic invoicing, and electronic invoicing is part of the procurement process where the government goes from a manual system to an electronic transfer system. And then information on quality, this will provide project evaluation, that this is recommend guidance or planning for investments in the public sector, and there could be a better integration between the public sector and the private sector. So because some of the contacts are made, of course, with private sector, so. And investment is expected to cost $750 million, subject to some quality funds. And these are some of the sites we saw, and this has come away with different levels of order. And we speak about the state level, you can also get access to the other levels as well. If there was something else I wanted to say, I haven't put it up yet, but I will put up two documents on my website, and I can place them in my website. I haven't put them up yet because I don't have time. One of the documents is about, I don't actually bring it up right now, but it's about Alton. And Alton was the company that was hired for the public sector as providing the e-government toolbox. So they're providing the e-government infrastructure. And it says that they, many government agencies need to switch to, they now need to switch to electronic forms. And that they want to be able to provide, or they will be providing, being able to fill out public forms electronically and provide training for this and provide services 24/7. The types of services that Alton provides are submission services, message services, access services, link services, transmission services, and collaboration services. And for example, collaboration services, this is the top services can be linked together to provide comprehensive processes that involve more users and one or more public agencies. Process can take place over a period of time, and various agencies can involve carrying out parts of the process. So they're involved in providing support for electronic procurement, for example, and by allowing the providing the form services and the transmission services and links between the different agencies and public sector. Okay. So I will put this topic very generic. It doesn't have anything to do with it doesn't go into detail about the technology that's actually used, but it just talks about the kinds of services that they're actually providing to the public sector. What I wanted to show is what is happening in Europe today with digitization of the e-government. A report that was done by the European Commission in Brussels, and they were talking about digital government and how it is changing and the needs for all citizens. So it's talking about there's different types of social and economic changes in Europe, and a lot of states are being hit with economic problems and crises, that there's still a need for digital technology and digital change in the government. And there's still some says that this company called Accenture did a survey and they developed this report for this agency. And it said that the citizens are experiencing expectations with digital channels in the government. And they said that the response is that the percentage of respondents using digital channels today that is very often. And that the blue one is the percentage of respondents who think that it is important for government to provide more services to digital channels in the future. And you see that there's somewhere around 30, 40, 50% that are using digital services. And surprisingly, India has 76%. I did not know that. Singapore is very high, but then some more. And that there's most places would like to do more digital services. And the questions I want to ask are what kinds of benefits can digitization bring to countries, and how can countries evolve and become more digitally mature in providing public services? And they categorize Europe in different types of categories. So there's the cutter countries, and these are countries that are hard hit by global volatility and are focusing on reducing government spending. So then they have well-developed infrastructures, but the government wants to prioritize prioritization of information and communication technology is moderate. So they're not really highly prioritizing this. And that the perceived government effort is in leveraging the digital drive for greater economic competitiveness. So they don't want to spend a lot, but when they do spend, they want to become more competitive. The countries in this category include France, Greece, Ireland, Italy, Japan, and Netherlands. And also Poland, Russia, Spain, United Kingdom, United States. The builders are emerging economies that have strong economic growth, which maybe they don't have infrastructure yet. They have an emphasis on building out the core information and communication infrastructures with new technologies. The digital maturity and the digital maturity and delivering the value outcomes remains constrained by unequal access to information, communication, technology, and education. So that means there's a difference between the haves and have-nots and who have access to information. So these companies have growing economies, they're building out their infrastructures, but there's still a difference between who can access the infrastructure. And the Indian government has developed a national e-governance plan that operates across both state and local level, towards transparency and citizen-centered services. The government sees ICT as a means to ensure that the citizens across countries, especially those who are marginalized, get access to the government benefits and services. Examples of building countries are Brazil, China, India, Indonesia, Mexico, Saudi Arabia, South Africa, Thailand, Turkey, and the United Arab Emirates. And then we have enhancers. And the enhancer countries are developed economies that are doing fairly well. They have a strong, in a strong fiscal position. They also have built up, well-developed ICT infrastructure. And they have invested in digital government to drive citizen satisfaction, economic competitiveness, and public sector efficiency. Digital government could be further leveraged to drive greater citizen engagement. And they plan examples for this Waves framework. We're going to have provide excellent oversight in the public sector and the central government regions and municipalities have approved the new e-government strategy to accelerate the adoption of digital solutions for the public sector. And in this category, we have Australia, Canada, Denmark, Germany, Malaysia, Norway, Singapore, and South Korea. So this is the situation we're in, good economic position, good ICT infrastructure, and the new focus area will be further on citizen engagement. The model that they used when they created was the government digital maturity indicators, and they used to calculate like digital priority, how much they're prioritizing these investments, ICT development, public sector, productivity, economic competitiveness, citizen engagement, and constituent satisfaction. And you see the orange one is the enhancers, so focus on citizen engagement, constituent satisfaction, digital priority, ICT development, carry time, and then public sector productivity. And this is a competitive. So this is what they cover the country. So they see it as four challenges facing digital government. One of the challenges is government. And that is you need the mandate from policymakers to go forward with your plans. And they suggest that appointing government leaders where a single CIO can bring the problem together. And then European digital strategy as an opportunity to raise profile of digital government. So they talk about how to motivate changes within the government and just cast some sort of mandate that the government should make these changes. And that build mechanisms for collaborations, forums, virtual, real, to exchange best practices between players in the digital public sector. On the citizen engagement, they talk about experts suggest that the citizens be citizen-centered, produce devices that are also meeting with the citizen specifications, improve access at the home, improve access to elsewhere through digital services that may be available to libraries, offer new channels, like being able to access government services through mobile technologies, and making use of interoperability services with cloud-based solutions. Privacy and security. So many countries don't really trust the government electronic services. So in the UK, the government is banning attempts to introduce electronic ID cards and make public disclosures, so they don't have public ID cards. And it says that the experts suggest that you have to sell the services, you have to market them so that the citizens will understand the rewards offered by the services. You need to improve interoperability, balance security, and communicate effectively and gain the trust of the citizens. So you need to change the mindset of the public to be able to understand the services that are also being to become better satisfied with the services. But they need to be able to trust the infrastructure as well. And then the cross-sector partnership, this is a big change, and that the government is not only a government's public services anymore, but should encourage more interaction with the private sector as well. conflict with the public sector policy. To stimulate competition and innovation, but I wish one would be more limited. So government also wants to be competitive. And in other nations like India, private sector involvement can be the key accelerating digital government through stages that decouples and enhances talent to deal with one by one. So be agnostic about who you're dealing with. So don't put a prejudice on dealing only with public sectors, although this is also enable yourself to deal with private sectors, projects as well. Work with the private sector employees to improve teamwork training and increase collaboration with the public sector. So there needs to be close training between public and private sectors so that everybody understands their role in the project. And improve the experience for young people working in the public administration, and so cutters and hunters countries can take their lead from the diverse playbook and engage the private and non-government actors to become part of the value chain of service delivery. So including the private sector in the service delivery for public services as well. Responding to the digital challenges. You can read this here from the internet. The main kind of key point here that this should be a true strategy and strategic vision, and that you need to train people and educate people. And there's a whole scale need to digital government, in the end, likely to require the element of compulsion with mandatory requirements to engage from public services on a digital basis. And this is actually what has been a mandate in the Norwegian government, that services will be moved to digital services. So the e-procurement will become other procurement, will become e-procurement, and that the transfer forms will take place digitally. And the interaction between citizens and government will take place digitally. And citizens to be at the center, and then in the silos, where you just have one department interacting with a citizen, that there should be the citizens to be able to interact with all departments and restore the public trust. Pathways to digital maturity. And then find it. And then here in Norway, as Elton has mentioned, the technologies that will help support the transformation are social networking technologies that allow citizens to participate. And they also mention getting the views from the citizens with e-petition. And I forgot to mention on the Molde community website, there is a way to submit or to initiate an e-petition process. So that's actually in place in the community as a way of getting feedback from the citizens. And it's not a discussion form, but it's a way to just begin a petition process. And then mobile technologies, being able to access things anywhere, the services from anywhere. So having this is important for countries that have a lot of people that are dispersed geographically, for example, or that people don't always have high-end technology computers. and they might access government services through their mobile phone, for example, or even educational services through their mobile phone. And China and India are kind of pioneering the way of finding services through mobile technologies. And then analytics, they can use of big data sets to identify new opportunities for governments in the public administration, but also in their partnerships with private administration. And then cloud computing has solutions or platforms to allow different agencies to communicate and have access to different areas, such as Norway's central digital government platform operates in this way, so that all of the departments operating digital government through a single platform rather than separate silos, and they're able to communicate with each other. So Norway is making use of the cloud service through Altium. And the European Cloud Initiative represents the potential to build out such solutions on a transnational basis. So the idea is to be able to also provide services between countries in a digital way as well. So I would recommend if you're interested in learning more about this, that I would recommend you to kind of look up the European Cloud Initiative as well. This is a nice document and gives some insight into this, really the state of digital government today. And I will put it up on the website so you can read it and take a look at it. I just need to put something for you. There was a place for making my own contribution. But there was a place where you could only create a petition. And you can have an online petition. And I can find it. So I think that's all I want to cover today. I know we had said it would be a long I pray that I can be covered by the points for you, Diana. And then on Thursday, we will have another one. So, I'm just we can take a look at the first link, and I'll put up the this one. That I just talked about. And on Thursday, we'll talk about the kind of ICT interface.